Welcome to As the Story Grows. I'm Brian Patton. Today we welcome Shayley Bourget from Dayshell to the podcast. The new Dayshell record, Pegasus, is out this Friday, September 22nd. Shayley talks about joining Of Mice and Men, the back injury that led him to reconsider his place in Of Mice and Men, and upended his life, the struggles of being on a label, and why Pegasus is his last album. This was a delightful conversation, and I enjoyed getting to know Shayley a lot. In the show notes are links to the newsletter, Patreon, and Discord server. Get behind-the-scenes stories on the newsletter, early access to episodes on Patreon, and new music suggestions, Star Wars conversations, and more over on Discord. Also, make sure you're subscribed to the podcast on your favorite podcast platform and never miss an episode. Enjoy today's chat with Shayley from Dayshell. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Doing good, man. Doing good. Thanks for hanging out today.
Appreciate it. No problem. Thank you.
Yeah. Where are you hanging out these days? Where are you living?
I'm still in SoCal. Never really left. I'm in the boonies out in the high desert, kind of near Anza in Temecula.
Okay. Cool. How's life these days? How are things treating you?
All right, just working hard, doing the whole solo adventure. It's hard, but it's more worth it, in the long run, doing what I'm doing, not having to deal with people or labels or being broke.
Yeah. Yeah, there's definitely financial benefits to controlling everything in-house and being your own master, but there's financial risk too, but the risk and reward, it's high on both ends.
Yeah, at least in my position, I'm in control of my either perseverance or failure.
yeah, for sure. What was growing up like?
In Southern California?
Yeah.
As a kid, it was cool. Lots of skateboarding. I lived right on the lake because I was born and raised pretty much in Lake Elsinore, so it's kind of a big, nice man-made lake that started from a flood, and then they ended up making it a huge lake. And then, you got the left side of the lake and the right side of the lake, and one's a little poorer, one's more sophisticated. Lots of skateboarding, lots of dirt bike riding, because this is the capital of MX racing and stuff. There's Grand Prix here, and it's quite cool. Cool city, but, still shitty gangs and drugs and tweakers and... not the best place to live, but not the worst.
Yeah. It's that shit is everywhere. It's
pretty much.
No matter where you live, nice parts of town, bad parts of town, in the middle of the country, on the coast, it's everywhere.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. What got you into music?
My dad has always been kind of a musician. He's written tons of songs, self-produces them, nothing special. So I was always surrounded by, him. He's a phenomenal songwriter and guitar player. And, I just watched him. And of course he wanted me to get into music and stuff, but, I had to find my, calling on my own. And basically, I started to kind of enjoy music and I really wanted to start playing drums. So that's what I started out on. But one day I invited my best friend over and he played the drums and he was better than me. And I was like, all right, well, you play the drums and you teach me a little guitar riff, dude, and we'll just jam since you're better. I only knew two or three beats, and he taught me one riff, and that was the moment, that was the moment where I felt it and I fell in love with guitar. I don't know what, because I liked drums, but guitar just really spoke to me, and the power with distortion, and the first time I hit a palm mute, and that was it. It literally, that moment was the defining moment of my up until now.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Nice. Nice. At what point did you start trying to form bands? I mean, just right there with your friend?
Oh, immediately. Yeah. We had a band. We ended up recruiting our other best friend to play bass because he kind of started playing, and we started a band in middle school. We were the only band in middle school, and we called ourselves Penalized.
Nice. That's not a shitty first band name. You know, they're way worse ones.
Yeah, I know. It's hard to come up with band names, man. Yeah. It's one of the hardest things. That's why Dayshell was easy, because I was like, well, it's my middle name. I don't have to feel self-conscious about the band name or regret it. It's just, it is what it is, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Because there was like a good, like, you know, motocross, BMX, like whatever scene happening. But is there also a good music scene?
Not necessarily. It was kind of like we created our own, you know, community and scene. There was a couple bands. One band actually got signed and went on Warp Tour, but ended up eventually breaking up and not doing anything. But that was about it. And then there was us, and we were kind of like this, or at least speaking for myself, I was just a hungry musician that didn't care to get paid. We just wanted to play anywhere and everywhere all the time. So we were kind of like the household band in the town at the time, and kind of created the scene because, you know, more bands followed, and we started to play shows, and more bands started to join in our town. So it was really cool. And I don't know how it is now, but I doubt that it's as cool as it was when we were doing it. Cause you know, things have changed. You know, I don't know. I don't know how it is. I'd love to see if there is a scene out there right now.
How'd you end up in Of Mice and Men?
I knew Tino, the drummer. He was in a band called Lower Definition, and they were a band from San Diego. We were a band from Lake Elsinore, and you know, we found each other online through MySpace at the time. We started playing local shows together, or we'd play a show out in San Diego, and then he'd come out to our hood and play a show. And you know, I kind of knew him. I didn't really talk to anybody in that band. I'm still to this day, I'm not the first person to come up and talk to you. But once you talk to me, you know, you better be prepared because we'll talk forever.
Yeah.
He hit me up one day and said, hey, on MySpace, he's like, hey man, I got a proposition for you. I started this band with, you know, Austin from Attack, and you know, it's gonna be huge, dude. Are you interested? Like, we're gonna tour everything. We're gonna make money. And I was like, yeah, man. Like, let me know. Send me some demos. And then he kind of like ghosted me for like 4 months. And then I hit him back up, and I was like, hey, man. Like, what's going on? Just check back with this, see if you're still interested. I definitely want to see what's going on. He's like, sorry, man. We found somebody else. And then I was like, oh, all right. Well, whatever. I mean, I didn't really know what I was missing out on. It's completely kind of naive with all that, but you know, I didn't have a band at the time, so or I did maybe. But anyways, he ended up like hitting me up several months later after that, and he's like, hey man, so the singer that we decided to work with didn't work out, and none of us really like him or being around him. You still interested? The only quarry is we're leaving to record the album in a week and a half, and you would have to come try out like tomorrow or something. I don't remember. And if we choose for you to be in the band, then you're basically going to rehearse with us and then get up and leave. And then from the studio, you're going to go straight on tour. And then the rest is history. No so way. I was like, sure. I came out just looking like a dumb beach bum with V-neck shirt on, sandals, sunburnt. You know, I had my Explorer guitar just totally not fitting in. But, you know, the songs were so easy for me to play that I just nailed it. And I guess, you know, they liked my personality, and then I wrote stuff and sang it, and then the next following day they're like, you're in. I'm like, okay. So it's kind of weird because you're like, I literally just like walked into the door of the beginning of the rest of my life. And yeah. I didn't even know it at that time, you know, and I didn't even know them. I barely even knew Tino, so it was very new to me, but for the most part it was cool, you know.
Yeah. Was the band already signed to Rise Records at that point?
Yeah, they were already signed. Already, just like I said, about to go record their first album with Joey Sturgis, and Yeah.
That's wild. That's wild. What was, I mean, you're kind of thrown into this Rise record scene immediately, and Austin having been an Attack. I mean, that scene, that metalcore scene at the time was just fucking huge. Like, what was it like for you to like join that band and be in this band as like the scene explodes around you?
Oh yeah. I don't know. Like I said, I'm always like one, I feel like I'm notorious for being naive to what's happening in the moment. So I didn't really think anything of it. In fact, I listened to that music, and if I'm being honest, I thought it was just generic and dumb, and like I was like, this is like, I could write this in my sleep, you know, kind of stuff. Like, why aren't we pushing ourselves? So I was kind of just like, whatever, you know, I'm just having fun rocking out, headbanging with my friends and stuff. But it took me a while to start appreciating what was going on in the music as mm-hmm. I was there, because there's a lot more than face value. Excluding the singers, because most of the metal singers just suck. You know, let's just throw that out there. I'm not pointing any fingers, but most of them are just like whatever. But the musicianship and, you know, this post-hardcore metalcore was so enticing to me. Mm-hmm. And I really fell in love with it, and it changed my whole like outlook on writing at that moment, you know. And that's why, like, if you listen to Dayshell or you listen to my prior material before Mice and Men, it was more like rock and roll, mm-hmm. heavy rock. And then from a Mice and Men to now, like, it changed my whole outlook and I you know, how I write and approach metal and, you know, whatnot. So
yeah. After the second record, you leave the band. What led you to call it a day with the Mice and Men?
Quite a few things. The leading thing was I had a really bad back injury that still punishes me every single day of my life. While I was in that band, I had a nasty spill one night, and it was like I woke up the next day, you know, didn't really feel nothing, and then slowly, as the days, like up to 3 days, I started to feel this weird sensation in my back that I couldn't describe, and then it just started to spiral, and then that pain was so severe to me that it was just, you know, messing with my head. I started drinking more, you know, obviously, you know, when you're on the road, it's mm-hmm. it's just constant go, everybody's drinking, everybody's this, I'm in pain. So it's like, well, you know, we don't have any money. You may have thought back then that Mice and Men had money. We did not have a dime. I had $5 in my wallet a day playing sold out B market shows. And I was still just every night falling asleep, baffled the fact that my wallet is empty and I'm living off of free meals from fans. So there was no money for me to get any, you know, medical treatment or understanding. Plus the band and the boys, just I feel like they didn't really understand the severity of what I was going through. Mm-hmm. Kind of just shrugged it off, like, he's just over exaggerating, he's just this, maybe. I don't know what they're thinking, but that's what I was thinking, I was like feeling in a way. But that just drove me to drink, and then I was self-medicating, and then the self-medication started to turn into just 24/7. And I was medicating not only my body, but my mind, because, you know, when you're in torture, like, I describe this as torture, and I'm not saying it lightly, but when you're feeling that, you know, your mind starts to drift and go into dark places. If there's no end to something, and this is the rest of your existence and agony and having to drink your pain away, you know, you start to go crazy. And, you know, I kind of did. I kind of had like a mental breakdown and stuff. And, you know, it was on tour, and then I ended up flying home. The band left me. I had like a breakdown, and then I got thrown into the cuckoo lounge or whatever you call it, where, you know, they assess you to make sure you're okay and not going to kill mm-hmm. yourself or somebody, because I was like talking that way because I was just losing it. And I woke up, you know, like, I think it was like 24 hours or 48 hours later, I got out, called the guys. They had already left me. So I was just like by myself. Just with a shirt, no socks, no underwears, pants, and my cell phone and a charger in the middle of Florida.
Oh,
just,
man.
Like, oh, wow. I just went through one of the most traumatizing experiences ever. And guess what? Now I'm don't even know where I'm at. And my phone broke right at that moment, of course.
Jeez.
So, yeah, that was it. I went home. I thought about it a lot. I started to try to get my health in order. Had a meeting with the guys, you know, when they came back from tour. When I showed up to the meeting earlier than on time, I showed up to see them all finishing their meal. And I think that feeling right there really said, you know what, this is weird. Like, you know, there's something missing in this puzzle that I'm trying to build in my life. And these people, although I do not hate them or think they're bad or evil, we're just not the same.
Yeah.
And I'm going through my own stuff and I can't drag the boys down with me. And that's just not right, especially when I'm not feeling the brotherhood that I want, because it was just going to make it really hard for me moving forward, because I felt like at that point, no matter what, I was going to constantly have a target on my back with these guys. Like, they're always going to be making sure I ain't doing something wrong or this or that. Like, you know what I mean? Like that,
yeah.
That weight on top of the already stacked weight, I didn't need. So I decided, we had that meeting. I was sober. I was sober the whole time from when I went home and I was ready to do it. But I felt inside of me like this isn't my place. Mm-hmm. And I had to leave, and that was that. I mean, there wasn't no like animosity or anything. It was just a strange feeling to just, realize that you need to work on yourself. And mm-hmm. also like this place that this career you could have built with these guys is just not your home. You have to come to terms with that. Like, these people, although are great people, they're just not my people.
Yeah. Yeah. Was that first Dayshell record, like, on top of like you start that project almost immediately after you leave, was that kind of how you processed sobriety and all these feelings of abandonment or like not having this found family you thought you did?
Oh no, not at all. Actually,
nope. Okay.
I was hoping that was going to be the light at my end of my tunnel, but in fact it was more of the darkness forming more around me, because I just went straight from my old habits from a mice to Dayshell with a clean slate with people that didn't have to see me go through it all those times. And it just got darker and darker, and then on to the next album it was the darkest, and then it wasn't until like 6 years ago where I finally just like woke up one day after so many times of embarrassment and letting people down and text messages you regret that you never sent before, mm-hmm. like stuff like that, where you're just like, the amount of guilt that I would feel every single time I would drink and then come down, because I was also like killing myself. Like, and I don't mean that just because I was drinking, I was legitimately like drinking myself to death, where I was having full blown seizures where all my muscles would lock up and I couldn't breathe. And had to be thrown into the hospital. I was having, if you've seen like Intervention or something, mm-hmm. it's basically that, like one of those people, but it wasn't, and you drink, you have fun one night, and then I just couldn't stop. Cause yeah. It's just like, I would wake up with just severe anxiety and fear. And like the world was like closing down. So I would drink, but then like after I would drink so much that I'd end up in a hospital or something and come out of it, the immense amount of guilt would flood over me, and it would make me suicidal. Like, I don't deserve to live. I don't need this. I don't, like, look at me. I'm just nothing, like all the words I was telling myself. So that was like the darkest. But when I turned 30 years old, something in me just snapped and I just stopped cold turkey. And I never went back. And I'd never have any desire to. It was just like enough was enough, and yeah. The guilt was enough. And there was a few situations with people that still to this day, I'm so embarrassed and disappointed and filled with shame that I was that way. And I just never want to feel that shame ever again. It's worse than any physical pain known to man,
Yeah. 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 I get that. I've been sober since, over 3 years now. So I get it.
Congrats, dude. Yeah. It's better. I mean, it's hard. Trust me.
Yeah.
It's hard to be around people that are drinking and having fun. Uh-huh. And you don't relate anymore. And you're very, mm-hmm. You're just an outcast more than you were. But, I'd rather be the outcast than the guy that's just drunk, pissing his pants and people and letting people down left and right. I'd rather be the guy that is just doesn't fit in. Sure.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that kind of then what Mr. Pain is about? Like where that title comes from?
Yeah, basically, I am. I'm just a guy that lives in just pain and agony. Like right now I'm in pain. Yesterday I was in severe pain. I couldn't even walk. Like I pull it off, right? You wouldn't even mm-hmm. notice on my socials, because when you live in it so long, you just learn how to cope. Yeah. And, but yeah, I am Mr. Pain. Like the amount of pain that I go through is torture. So and there's no fix, you know, like there's, I've gone to doctors, x-rays, CAT scans, you name it. Everybody's saying, well, you know, we're not seeing anything that we can fix. It just might be just nerval stuff. And I've gone to the chiropractor a million times. So not only is it a prison and torture, there's really no definitive answer as to like what happened when I fell, because there's no like visual like explanation from it, only just speculation. And that bothers me still to this day, because you know, I just wish it was like, oh, this is the problem and this is what you're gonna live with, rather than we don't know, so just keep trying, spending money, you know, and never find out.
right man, I relate. I have a heart condition, and they're like, we thousands of dollars in tests at this, they're, nobody knows.
So frustrating, man. I'm sorry, man. Sorry you have to go through that. That's horrible.
Yeah, it's like, this is what I'm paying all this money for. To not know, and to, yeah, it sucks.
And it's defeating too. Every time you go there and you're like, oh, maybe this is the moment I at least get an answer. Even if there's not a cure, at least I can tell people what is wrong with me, other than I fell and I have nerve damage. Because that's the only thing I can figure, because, you know, it just hurts. Like, there's no bone, or you can't touch it. It's just this physical radiating pain that goes all through my lower back, you know, just on an extreme level. But yeah, it just sucks when you don't know, you know. It's just so disappointing and defeating.
Let's talk about some music. Your first record as Dayshell comes out on Sumerian, the second one on Spine Farm. Was that just kind of a product of, I mean, did that come from your self-destructive life at the time? Or was it just like you couldn't find an audience with the music you were making?
I think it's like, you know, I've thought about this a lot of times. Of course, you know, the initial thing that most bands will do is they'll blame the label for everything and this and that. And most of the time that, you know, that blame is usually right in this vicious industry. But I'd like to think that it was, you know, probably like a jumble of three things, you know, one being, Dayshell is a very odd band. Like, it's not that it's the most unique and weirdest band ever. It's just like, where do you put them? Where do you put Dayshell? They're not like super hard and heavy, but they're not super soft, and they're not poppy, but they're not necessarily radio rock. Like, where do you put us? So it was always kind of like a struggle to place us with bands that we would, you know, gain from, you know, a lot of the tours that we went on with Sumerian, they were just throwing us on death metal bands, and we nobody liked us, you know? But you know, I think that, you know, I think it's, that is one of the reasons. Another reason is I would say the labels, you know, they're always kind of telling, and I'm not like dogging on Sumerian or any of these labels, but you know, I am allowed to have my own opinion on how the release went out and how they handled it. I you know, I didn't see much marketing, even though we had a huge you know, budget for that. I didn't I saw like two ads or something, you know. It didn't seem like they were pushing it the way that they wanted to. Maybe they gave up before the album was out. Who knows? And another third factor, I just believe it was like I was still struggling with my alcoholism. And I was also with, you know, people in a band that weren't pushing, you know, as hard as we could. You know, it was just, they kind of were just like waiting for the label to do things or for me to do something or write something. And it was just like a recipe for a lot of, you know, for no movement, you know. And I think, you know, all those factors put together that kind of led us there. And then, you know, on to Spine Farm, it was just kind of like the same scenario, but with a smaller or a less big label that didn't have the type of pull and marketing Sumerian did. So it was basically, they released our album and that was it. Like, I didn't see like one ad, there was nothing. And then they eventually dropped us like a year later, which was, I was not bummed about by any means. And yeah, so I don't, you know, you don't really know. You can only speculate. I truly believe that Dayshell is not a bad band and is writes songs that are better than a lot of these metal bands that are, you know, doing a lot better. But, you know, there's always so many other factors. Like, maybe we just don't have the look. You know, I was a lot more overweight back then because of my drinking. And maybe that, like, you know, everybody's really, you know, that's important. You know, how you look, right, how you present, right, yourself, how you are online. If you don't have any of that, especially this day and age, like, you're worthless to these labels. And, you know, it's whatever to them. They'll just let you go or just, like, lead you on. The thing that I don't like, one thing that I will say about labels is, hey, you know, guys, if you decide you don't want to work with the band anymore, can you just please tell us immediately instead of waiting 2 fucking years for us to literally waste our life waiting for answers and emails from you? Like, that to me is evil. Like, I don't care that you don't want to work with us and you want to drop us, but 1.5, 2 years of just playing games and then finally dropping us and we're just dead, you know, fish in the water. Dead fish in the water, like that really hurts, because you can't get those 2 years back. You can't get that youth back. That's that one thing. I just won't ever let that one go, because it always bothers me when I think about it.
Yeah. Because you took Mr. Payne under your own wing, it's funded by fans, you're producing it. And because by 2019, you know, the streaming services have really taken over the music industry, did you find yourself freer in what you're writing? Because that record, it's really diverse. I mean, all your records are diverse, but like that one, you really see the diversity start to ring out more than the previous two.
Yeah, that album was, you know, the idea of that album was, I really thought it was over for me. You know, I didn't think my mind could handle it. I was newly sober, right? I was like, really, everything was fresh. So if you may know this, like, as an addict, when you're an addict for so long and you're coping and you're using drugs or alcohol to put a band-aid on your feelings of what you're feeling, when you quit any substance and you just cold turkey and you're now sober, all these emotions that you would normally cover up and mask and whatnot, you have to now face head on. And for however many years, my mom actually introduced this idea to me, however many years that you were an addict, is how it, like, let's say at 20 years old, I became an addict, and at 30 years old, I quit. Those 10 years I have to make up for. And those are 10 years of emotions that I suppressed with substance. And those are 10 years of emotions that I now need to learn how to digest and understand sober. And it's very hard because you're so used to this. And it wasn't that like, oh, I wanted to drink, because when I quit, I quit. I haven't looked back. It, like, I don't crave it anymore, but it's hard to process your emotions, and you almost feel like, I would say, like an addict that quits, you're like bipolar for the first month, because you have no idea how to control your emotions anymore. Because, you know, normally when you're pissed, what would you do? Grab a bottle, grab a beer. When you're sad, you grab a beer and it all goes away. Now you're mad and you have nothing to grab, you know? So it's like, it was hard, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's talk about this new record, Pegasus. I love it. I had it on in the background this morning, and Return of the Doc played, and my daughter was in the other room, and she was like, are you listening to Owl City? Which was quite funny. So that just talks about, like, the diversity. You work with Joey Sturgis again on this record. What led you to Joey?
Well, I love Joey. Joey is my greatest inspiration in the production world and mentor from afar. You know, we worked together on the first two of Mice and Men albums. I had no idea who he was. I'm really naive to the producer world in general before I joined of Mice and Men. I didn't care about producers. I didn't look them up. I didn't know who did what. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to rock. But I met him in there, and we were instantly like, we clicked, because Joey's so good at what he does, and he's usually rarely in a situation when he's with a musician that's really good at what they do. So when he was working with me, him seeing how fast I am at what I do and how I hear 18 harmonies and can nail them right away and explore, it was just like a kid in a candy store for him to explore and make, you know, the best version of a song with an artist, rather than trying to get the artist to play the bare minimum of this, what the song needs, you know? Yeah. So that chemistry really worked between us. And he showed me, you know, he showed me so much I could do with my voice that I never thought I could do, you know, because most producers you work with, they kind of have this playbook of what's wrong and what's right. Joey's more like, well, let's just see if we can make it work. Let's not, you know, so I was able to do things with my voice that I never thought I could put on recording, which opened up the window and the doors to a broader voice that I now utilize to this day. So after that, on my Cement album, I instantly hit up Joey right away when I joined Dayshell to produce. But at the time, he had retired. Hit him up again for Nexus, still retired. And then once he heard Mr. Payne, I got the email. And he said, dude, please, for the love of God, let me produce your next album. And I was like, well, duh, dude. Like, let's go. Like, so it's just been kind of like, we've been talking back and forth throughout the years. And finally, the moment came. And he actually wasn't going to produce this album originally. I had somebody locked in, but things didn't work out. So I hit up Joey and asked him, I was like, yo, dude, let's do it. You know, and he was kind of skeptical, actually, because he was like, here's the thing. I really want to do the album, but I'm afraid to do the album to taint, like, because he's like a huge fan of Dayshell. It's one of his favorite bands in the world. He didn't want to taint that whole, like, how do you say this? Like, you know, like, perception of me, like, you know, what can happen when you go in a studio with somebody you really look up to and you're recording with them, it could change your whole outlook on each other. Now you hate this guy, you don't like his music. Like, I think he was afraid that was going to happen.
Yeah.
And that's totally understandable. And I can totally relate with that. I even told him, well, dude, no worries. Like, I get it. Like, I understand what you're trying to say here. But if you do choose, like, I think it could be a really good thing. And, you know, he thought about it and then he said, you know what? I think this is something I need to do, because after I sent him like the first demo, which was You With, that was the first demo I sent him.
Oh, nice.
And he just went like, holy crap, I got to do this. So yeah. And it was great. Like, working with him was different. Like, I was worried. I had, you know, for me, I was like paranoid because I've had horrible experiences with producers in my past. And I was like bracing myself for that the whole time with him. You know, we're not best friends, but we're definitely like family, if that makes sense. Like, we've known each other for so long, but we don't talk on the regular. We were so busy doing our own things. And so it was kind of like getting to know him again. But like the moment we connected and we got in the studio, it was just after like the first day, you know, kind of warming up. He's a little shy. But after the first day, we were just back to being prepubescent teens making silly noises every second and just enjoying ourselves, you know? So yeah. I can't thank him enough. You know, he helped so much more than I thought he was going to. And still to this day, like, he's the man, dude. He posts everything that I post, but he cares. Like, I can't thank him enough. I love him to death.
Album's called Pegasus. Where'd that title come from?
Pegasus is actually my dad's band's name back in the 80s. So he had a band called Pegasus that didn't go anywhere, but I just thought it would be a good pay good homage. Plus, visually, you can make the most majestic shit, you know, as seen on the cover, you know. Yeah. So that was kind of it. It doesn't really have a meaning other than I would say picking up where my dad left off and hopefully finishing what he started to make him proud.
Nice. Yeah. The album artwork is like spectacular. Who did the design and like, where'd that concept come from?
Kevin Moore with Soft Surrogate, one of my best dudes ever. This guy's been a, just so important to me. And he's so kind and patient and helpful. Without him, this album wouldn't have, I would have probably lost it if it wasn't for his help, because, you know, he does all the art, but he also just cares enough to be like, he knows that I'm independent. So he's helped get like all the physical CDs situated, the vinyl situated, you know, talking to this guy, trying to get this guy to do the merch and finding deals. He's just like kind of like a, I would almost consider him almost like a day-to-day kind of like a manager in a way to me at times. You know, when I come to him with when I need something, he's just like there. He's just on it. One of my greatest friends, and not to mention, he's one of the greatest top dog artists in the industry right now. You know, he's done everybody. He's done Korn. You know, he's just one of the greatest dudes, and he's so, so talented.
Yeah, yeah. It's a like super dope artwork. What was inspiring you lyrically, and what were you drawing upon when you were writing this record?
It's hard to say, because a lot of the times when I write my songs, I don't go in with a concept of what I'm writing. You know, because the music usually comes first. It's very rare that, you know, a melody and lyrics will come first, but that does happen. But, you know, most of the songs on this album were instrumental first, and then it's just a matter of, okay, now I got to write lyrics and melody. So I just get behind a mic and I start freestyling things and melodies and then just pulling words together, and I still have no concept. And it isn't till like I'm halfway through the song, I see what my intuition is trying to say, and then I'm able to build the rest of the lyrics off of what my intuition was, because I don't, like I said, I don't go in saying, I'm going to write this song about me being sad and this girl broke up with me. No, it's never like that.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, these words, this makes sense. And then you start building and you go, okay, this applies to this now in my life. So now I can kind of hone in on what I'm trying to say. But you know, there are some times in some songs that you've probably heard that I have no clue what the hell I'm singing about.
That makes sense. Yeah. You've gone from being, you know, in A Mice and Men, like the height of the CD era, to now everything's playlisted and streaming. Has that changed your approach to writing music and putting together an album?
Yeah, I think I'm a little more late to the game with this. But, you know, since I went independent and I did, you know, Mr. Payne by myself, and just seeing kind of how it worked, and seeing really, really being in on like the numbers and stream counts, and seeing like, oh, this song did like really well, but all the singles I did are getting the most plays, and all the other 10 songs on that 14 track album are barely getting plays. And I started to realize that, you know, albums are, although very valuable to people probably like myself and you,
yeah,
they're unrealistic in this day and age now, and it's so much unnecessary money being spent on a 10 song album when you only have two or three singles that see the light of the day, and then the rest of the songs barely get any plays, and it's basically you worked your ass off and you spent all that money and you're not getting any recoup. So, you know, for me, it's changed a lot. You know, this is my last album till further notice with this, and that's why I wanted to go as big as I could, getting Joey and launching a campaign for 50K. Because, yeah, the time, we all are going to conform. It's already happening. Bands are already doing it. Falling in Reverse is a prime example of, you know, an artist that says albums are worthless. Why not write the coolest song ever, put a bunch of money into an awesome video and marketing, and recoup all that and then some, and then just do that over and over. So that's pretty much, you know, where I'm at. Like, streaming has, the world keeps changing. People's attention is getting smaller and smaller. So moving forward, you know, the idea is to just really, really make each song I released as magical and awesome as possible, and put as much heart and soul and thought into it as possible. And rather than stressing yourself out, trying to scrounge around, you know, 30K to record a 10 song album with a legit producer and then barely make that money back, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. You're putting all your time and effort into like, all right, the single's out, and so like you have new music constantly, and people are always like, oh, new Dayshell, as opposed to like every 2-3 years, oh, a new album, and then like trying to tour to make that money or whatever you're doing, right?
Like, yeah, and it's, yeah, like, yeah, exactly. You're more consistent. If you're focusing on one song at a time, you have material out more frequently, rather than me, which Dayshell is notorious for taking 3-4 years in between each album, because there's so much shit that happens in between, labels dragging us on for 2 years, or I'm injured, or this happens in my life and I have to take a break, whatever it may be. So this is cool. But one thing I will do for this album, which I think everybody should be doing, and I don't know why they're not, is if you do record an album and you have like your, you know, your 2 or 3 singles, why are we not making content for the other songs after the album's released? Because really, realistically, if you think about it, you just need to promote your songs on your album, right?
Yeah.
Most people aren't like posting like clips and stuff of the songs that aren't singles. So nobody's looking for those songs. But if I spend a week, or if I record a video or a lyric video for a song, and I spend a week promoting that song that's on an album that's already released, you know, your stream count's going to go up, because people are going to be like, oh, I didn't know this song was on the album. This part's sick. I want to check it out. So that's my plan, to really use every last drop to this album after it's post-release. I got things planned to hopefully get some kind of video content and push for each song on the album within the, you know, the year of its release, you know?
Yeah.
Because why not? You know, the album's only released once. What are we doing just giving like two songs some spotlights, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I know like MXPX has an album out the end of this month, and I know they have a music video for every song on the album. Like, it's going to get played.
It's perfect. Yeah. That's how you got to do it. If you're going to do an album, then you better invest into visual content for every song. Otherwise, you know, it's going to cost more, or just be smart and, you know, find somebody that'll do, you know, do your three awesome or two or three awesome videos, and the rest like low budget lyric / you know, backdrop, cool live performance kind of shit, you know, anything really.
Yeah. Yeah. The album's out the 22nd. What does the rest of this year look like? Are you going to try to play shows, get on the road, or are you just going to work on creating digital content?
Yeah. The album's out September 22nd. After that, I have, you know, some music videos. You mentioned Return of the Doc. I plan on doing a video for that I'm going to shoot myself. And that's going to be out after the album. And specifically, I don't know, Return of the Doc, do you know what that song's about, or who's that song's about?
I do not.
Okay. I'll just try to give you a quick scenario if you don't know. But basically, there's this guy called Dr. Disrespect. He's a video game streamer that kind of has this alter ego, Macho Man Randy Savage type. You know, he has like a mullet and a mustache, and he wears glasses all the time, and he's just mad all the time. And he's kind of like the pest in the industry that talks shit on everybody and says the truth. But he's built this huge following. This whole, you know, his production is insane. He uses a green screen. He has like, makes it look like he's in space or in this multi-million-dollar arena that he says he lives in, and all this stuff. He's so hilarious, and he's gone through a lot, and he never gives up. And he's been like, kind of like there for me through all these times of, you know, the torture and the pain that I go through. And I watch him, you know, I'd watch him religiously. He streams for hours each day, and he's funny, and he just inspired me in a way. And I wrote this whole movie in my head about his life. I don't know why. So then I had to write this song, and I had this crazy idea for a video, green screen. The guy that was going to shoot it ended up backing out, so I'm going to shoot it myself. But anyways, back on track. Every October he does this thing called Doctober, which he has fans submit videos for a contest to win whatever, just a gift package. I could care less about the gift package, to be honest.
Sure.
What I care about is him seeing it, right?
Nice.
and if I do win, then the chances are he might post it. And the chances are, if he hears the song and sees all the lyric and all the lingo that I put in it that he says, he may use it for his like intro or something. So I'm really excited about it. And at the very least, I honestly just want him to see it. That would just be, you know, a dream come true. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm gonna do stuff for that.
Thanks for listening to As the Story Grows. Our intro music was written and composed by Jeremy Hunt. The As the Story Grows theme is by Bob Nana. If you like what you hear, subscribe wherever you get your podcast and give us a rating and review. If you'd like to support the show financially, you can join us at patreon.com/asthestorygrows. Be a part of our community and join the ongoing conversation over on Discord. If you enjoy this episode, share it on social media with your friends. Much appreciated, and thanks for listening. I never